The Drill on 1010XL. From the studios of Republic Services, we'll handle it from here.
Ross and Shy Gook, it's go time on a Tuesday morning. It's Cat the Truck Accessories Tuesday. The wait continues. Perhaps today is the day that he rides in on the white horse. And the man who I believe, the coach who I believe should have been the selection all along, maybe the Jaguars will get lucky and it'll just fall to them. I don't know at this point. It's a very odd dynamic. If you heard Uche Nwaneri on yesterday with a show that Hicken very affectionately calls The Lunch Bunch, I believe Beef as a program director de facto around here. What is the official title of that lunch show?
That is called XL Primetime.
XL Primetime. So let's emphasize the brand a little bit. But they had Uche on.
He's been very vocal in his criticism of Shad and the Jags and Trent Baalke, also his preference for them to hire his former teammate Byron Leftwich.
Well, he had a range of thoughts. He had tweeted something about Byron and then joined the boys on yesterday's noon show and had some interesting comments about where things stand. It's just a bizarre look at this point. It's hard to imagine what exactly the dynamic is. You've interviewed so many people. Certainly, you have settled on someone, which means there may even be unreported rebuffs. You know, we're not getting that side of. We're not getting which coaches are just saying flat out, yeah, no. I don't want to work with player, position X. In this case, Trent Baalke. I mean, it's just no secret that I won't say for whatever reason, but for reasons generated in San Francisco and the way things went down there, there's just an implication around Trent Baalke. Uche, we'll talk about that, among other things. And you'll hear from him coming up this hour. But, you know, in my mind, I kind of characterized, you know, just what the situation is down there at the stadium as we go through this process. And there's one particular metaphor that comes to mind. We'll expound on that here this hour. Aren't you lucky that you're going to get an expansion of my creativity a little bit later this hour? So thanks for being up. And Adam with us, it was Rich Bisacci yesterday interviewing for the head coaching job. So I can't imagine the look and the reality of hiring a Raiders interim head coach that they let go so they could hire the much more acclaimed and sought after Josh McDaniels. I mean, I don't know in what football world a playoff team gets rid of an interim coach, hires a coach that really has been in a lot of people's sights for a long time. Now, Josh McDaniels is going to have to buck a trend. You know, and that trend is he's been a losing coach in the NFL. A lot of times that second job can be a plum one. You know, you can show, you know, improvement. As good as Tom Coughlin was here, and he was really good. He was even better with the Giants, winning two Super Bowls. Bill Belichick with the Cleveland Browns was an average coach. On the New England Patriots became the GOAT. And so I'm sure Josh McDaniels is hoping the second time around. He had some interesting comments yesterday. A couple of the coaches were introduced yesterday, and we'll share their thoughts on their new teams. Man, it is a cliche fest, boy. Like, if we wanted to, like, take four recently hired head coaches, and I could find essentially the same quote from all four at some point, how the team is going to play with focus and energy and, you know, all these platitudes that every coach is suddenly going to reinvent with the same roster for the most part that said losing team had a year ago. So, but anyway, Bisacci interviews yesterday. Look, they speak highly of Bisacci. It's just, I mean, really, all the potential head coaching candidates that are out there and available on the planet, that's a kind of a strange one to me. So, I mean, at this point, it almost feels like, you know, they're flailing in the middle of the ocean, just grabbing at buoys and, you know, a life ring that just got thrown in. So, Bisacci yesterday, but now back to the lead, and perhaps we can end up where some of us believe we should have been all along, and that's Doug Peterson. Peterson will get a second interview with the Jaguars today. Again, who knows what the dynamics are between these coaches and the GM here. Because apparently that's where it starts and stops. It was almost a week and a half ago, we were all but announcing Byron Leftwich as the next head coach. Something went dramatically awry there. I would have preferred Peterson all along. So with a second interview today, maybe some sort of agreement can be made, and the Jaguars will be coached next year by a head coach who won a Super Bowl, who beat Bill Belichick and the Patriots 2 weeks after the Jags were unable to pull that off themselves in the AFC Championship game. Well, as we've been doing now, they've given us plenty of opportunity to become indeed for NFL coaching candidates. We'll go through the resume of Doug Peterson, a reminder of from whence he came and what he was able to accomplish. Look, it didn't end well. He wanted to stay in Philly. Even willing to make some adjustments. The quarterback situation went, off script there. Thought they had an emerging MVP candidate in Carson Wentz. He got hurt. Nick Foles enters the story. He's the hero. The hero, as always, holds a special place. So he had that dynamic, and then Wentz continued to play, played injured. The two at some point became got to the point they weren't even on speaking terms. Don't forget it was Peterson who first pushed Jalen Hurts into the lineup. Remember, they took Hurts in the second round, even though they had Wentz at the time. That was strange and apparently hurt feelings and a broken relationship between coach and quarterback. That certainly has to be addressed. That has to be completely understood. It's so important that Trevor Lawrence not have another lost year wandering in the desert with, 17 touchdown passes and 15 picks. We need rapid improvement here. We need that second-year jump that Herbert and Burrow both made this year. Herbert statistically, Burrow both statistically, and obviously results-driven as he has the Cincinnati Bengals, wow, in the Super Bowl. So Peterson today, Bisaccia yesterday, Uche Nwaneri on deck. You will hear what the former Jaguar starter on the offensive line told our friends on primetime yesterday. All right. Gather up, Gator and Noel fan. I got really bad news for you. What in its initial offering seems like, wow, isn't that cool? Oh, interesting to put this rivalry on a different platform. Let's really shake things up. And so while at first what I'm about to tell you seems like it's a feather, it's not. It's not. In fact, you know what it is? Congratulations, you're now Arkansas Ole Miss. You're now Mississippi. Listen, if you're Florida State right now, you wish you were as good as Ole Miss. Don't misinterpret what I'm saying. But the Florida State football game, this football season, is going to be played on the Friday after Thanksgiving. Welcome to Nebraska, Iowa. Way to take yourself off the schedule on the most important football day of the entire college football season is that Saturday after Thanksgiving. Right? Michigan and Ohio State are playing. Auburn and Alabama are playing. Florida is playing FSU. On down the line, the rivalries trickle in. Are we sure this isn't a basketball story? Maybe the Florida State basketball game will be played on Black Friday. No, Black Friday football for Florida State. They'll play on the Friday night after Thanksgiving. Yeah, that won't get lost in the shuffle at all. I mean, look, for those of you listening now, for all of us that root for Florida or Florida State, it doesn't matter when you play the game. You can play it at 8 o'clock on a Tuesday morning, whatever. We're watching. And so Friday night, well, yes, it'll be fun perhaps for, as something different for that game to be there. It'll also free up your football watching Saturday. And the way Florida and Florida State have trended lately, maybe that's the biggest bonus. You get to watch the real contenders compete for real you know, prizes at the end of the year. Meanwhile, don't look now, but the signing day concludes the, or, you know, late signing period now, I guess it's called. What used to be the NSD, National Signing Day, is this Wednesday. Don't look now, but Billy Napier has had his Florida Gator recruiting class rank shoot up, man. It wasn't long ago when Napier was named and the class just about completely fell apart. Remember, it was down to three or four guys? And then Napier rallied and got some really highly thought of players in the early signing period. But even still, the class was ranked like 60th. You know, before the signing day, it had been down in like the 70s and 80s. Well, look, Napier got his feet under him, surveyed the landscape, kept the ones he really wanted to keep, took the ones early that he really thinks will compete, and now is postured to snag a couple of the just few remaining elite talents that haven't signed yet. But I told you last week about the Perkins kid, Harold Perkins from Texas A&M, how he had decommitted. And look, he visited LSU last week in Florida the week before, down to the Gators in LSU. Florida is also in on a couple other prospects that could ultimately, believe it or not, have this recruiting class by Thursday all the way up to between 15 and 20, which would be a pretty good reclamation project. And I think it is telling that Napier is immediately hitting the road and keeping his footing against the two power players right now in Southern recruiting, Alabama Nick Saban, Georgia Kirby Smart. And so to just, you know, from keeping this Shamar James who had flipped to Georgia in the fold on the early signing day to literally getting equal billing with those programs in an attempt to land some of these last-minute guys. Now, look, don't kid yourself. Alabama, Georgia's programs, for the most part, put to bed, as is currently number one Texas A&M, who is experiencing a couple of decommits. But Napier has, according to ESPN's rankings, he's got the Gator recruiting class up to 26, which with the short time frame and basically resetting the recruiting class when he started, the Florida transfer class is also viewed as a top 10 transfer class. Something tells me that by the time the season starts, particularly if Anthony Richardson has a healthy, productive spring, something tells me expectations and optimism are going to dramatically ramp up by the time we get to September. It seems as with the new focus and momentum and then just the natural unbridled optimism that comes for all of us in our fan bases, I believe that by the time Florida hosts what might be a top five team in Utah to start the season, I think the expectation and the optimism will be a lot higher by then. So certainly holes on a roster that underperformed a year ago, particularly in the second half of the season. But by the way, FSU's entire football schedule has been unveiled. So when we come back on the other side, we're going to check in through the magic of drill creativity on the hostage situation that has developed down at the stadium. We'll hear from Uche Nwaneri, his perspective on the Sugar Show that has now dragged into 40-something days. We'll do both of those when we return and more up and rolling here on a Catlin Truck Accessories Tuesday. We also have a football fix that's coming up bottom of the hour and much more ahead. You're listening to The Drill on 1010XL and 92.5 FM. All right, we're back here on The Drill. Things have gotten desperate down at the stadium where we're bringing in Doug Peterson today. Perhaps he can save the day, but the whole thing now is drawn out to the point. It feels like we're in like a hostage negotiation, like, you know, this is Money Heist on Netflix or Die Hard. So, naturally, in a hostage situation, you have to negotiate with the hostage taker. At first, I'm not exactly sure. I know who's being held hostage. The fans are being held hostage. Perhaps some coaching candidates out there are being held hostage. maybe even Shot Khan himself for some reason is being held hostage. But 1010XL, always on the forefront, had the hidden microphones rolling this morning as hostage negotiations began.
Yeah?
Since you're answering the phone, I'm going to assume this is the man in charge in there?
Yeah. Trent Baalke. It's Trent Baalke.
I'm in charge.
All right. I want to talk to Mr.
Mr. Khan.
I want to hear from him that everything's okay
inside the house.
F*** you. I'm running this sh**. You talk to me.
That's right. You are running this. Tell me you're the man in charge. That'll be your responsibility. You understand?
F*** you. Don't try and play me. You get us a helicopter to fly us out of this.
Just a local paper pusher.
Get me a f***ing helicopter before I start shooting people.
Be cool. Be cool.
There you go. Things have gotten tense.
It is tense.
Tense down there with Trent Baalke. He's dug in. He's crouched behind his desk with a semi-automatic. Come and get me, fools.
That was tense.
We kid because we care. What are we, day 43 now?
I believe it's 46. 46. Was let go.
That is 46 of a rudderless ship.
I guess this would be day 47, I believe.
I guess so.
It's fine.
Yeah, but apparently, we things have gotten serious. I mean, we've at least sent in a negotiator. I mean, please set this franchise free.
Yeah, we do that. Paper pusher, was that Gene?
I don't. Did they go with Frenny? Well, I mean, good. Whatever it takes.
Whatever it takes, man.
Did they smit her down there? Is that what he meant by paper pusher? I think he meant an accountant, maybe. Maybe it was one of the accountants.
I thought it was one of the scribes.
Yeah, well, maybe that too. Whatever it takes, but Baalke seems pretty hell-bent and determined down there, doesn't he?
He dug in, man.
I mean, he's going to start shooting soon. So
that seems excessive.
I believe it. Doug Peterson, meanwhile, does get that second interview today. Peterson was a journeyman quarterback in the NFL and other leagues. Actually played for the Rhine Fire back in the day of that old World League of American Football when they put those franchises in Europe and nobody watched. But then he returned. He had an early career with the Dolphins, spent a couple, 3 years with the Dolphins. He was a Louisiana Monroe quarterback. I think, if memory serves, Peterson came into – I think Peterson played either Florida or Florida State, I believe. In his college career, late 80s, early 90s. I could be wrong on that. But after an early career, and then he went, played for the New Jersey Knights, whatever that was, the Rhine Fire along the way. And then he settled in for a good 10-year run as a backup quarterback.
Jersey Knights, the World League.
Okay, with the Packers primarily, also with the Eagles. But he got in that journeyman bounce around backup kind of stage. When he finished his career, he immediately became a head coach at the high school level. Then went to work for Andy Reid, and in 2009, he was the offensive quality control coach, 11-12, the quarterback's coach. Reid went to Kansas City. He took Peterson with him, and at Kansas City, he took on the role of offensive coordinator, which he held for 3 years. And that's when the Philadelphia Eagles came calling. So he got his chance to be a head coach. His first year there, they went 7-9. They were last place in the NFC East. But then a nice three-year run that started in 2017 when they won the Super Bowl. Followed that up with a wild card appearance in Philly, 9-7. Lost the divisional game, won a wild card game. And then the next year won the division again at 9-7, then lost to the Seahawks in a wild card game. And then in his final year, it went 4-11-1. Wentz was hurt. The quarterback situation was a mess. The locker room seemed to fracture a little bit more against Wentz, it seems, than against Peterson. But that is certainly a resume that is, you know, above 500 in the regular season, 4-2 in a Super Bowl in the postseason. Years of experience with, you know, the very well-respected Andy Reid, school of football. I mean, it makes all the sense to me. I would have started and stopped my search there. Now, you know, maybe I'll be wrong. I don't know. Maybe whatever flaws that were exposed in Peterson's last year in Philly will manifest again. You know, in those 4 years, really had one, or 5 years in Philly, had one outstanding year, 13-3. Other than that, he's a sub-500 coach there. You know, there's warts on everyone. And there's superlatives on most. But I, you know, between he and Caldwell, I all along, you know, to me, offer a, you know, a veteran steady. And know this, even though his career in Philly ended kind of awkwardly that way, Peterson is known through his players around the league as a culture guy. And I think it was telling, you know, we could even go back and look at some of the comments from that Philly locker room after Peterson was fired. But it sure seems I remember the players pointing more of the blame towards Carson Wentz, and that's rare. Now, not publicly, but that was the narrative. That the split, the problem, anything that was there that in that dynamic was more the responsibility of Wentz than it was Peterson. At least it seemed to me at the time, as I recall that storyline, that that's the way that it went down. So, meanwhile, Uche Nwaneri yesterday looks like he'd be willing to volunteer to do some negotiating with Trent Baalke. Nwaneri, who is still very much in communication with that organization, friends within the walls down there. And he sees it like the rest of us do, that there is just really one person, one position holding things up down there.
You know, I've spoken with someone who has a direct line to Shad Khan. Something about Trent Baalke, Shad Khan just absolutely loves. Now, I think personally that Khan is looking at this more as a businessman than rather from a football perspective, because generally, the sentiment that I've gotten from people who know him personally is that he's not a good dude. And I feel like right now it's more about self-preservation for him than actually advancing the franchise itself.
And that is that's the reputation, you know, the black mark, really, that Trent Baalke left San Francisco with. The way it all deteriorated there, a power struggle with Jim Harbaugh, the, I guess, proven allegations that he was leaking certain material that would shade things his way when it came to the, you know, the butting of heads between he and Harbaugh. Hiring Jim Tomasula, who was a friend at the time, with the understanding he would be the coach moving forward, firing him after 1 year. Again, painting a narrative through leaked sources that always seems to put the Teflon on him. And again, these are what veterans, San Francisco, this isn't a smear campaign. This is, if you ask why is there this, you know, this pushback, why is there this, you know, narrative around the situation? Well, this is why. And so that was, by the way, Tom Sula, he kept for a year fired and then hired Chip Kelly.
Chip!
Who was the second time through a disaster.
Had 1 year and then they were both fired.
Yeah, 1 year and then he left with Chip Kelly. And to my knowledge, didn't work for another NFL team until Dave Caldwell brought him in. How'd that work out for Dave Caldwell, by the way?
Well, they're going on their third coach in 3 years.
And how did it work for Caldwell?
Yeah.
When he brought in the top, his top assistant, whose head was on a platter out of town and who suddenly ended up GM?
It's interesting.
And people have said, you know, when it comes to like coaches picking GM, because I think Byron made a mistake with that. If he'd have just come in, bided his time, done 1 year, he could have had his wish. I firmly believe that. Uche Nwaneri said something that was very insulting to Shad Khan, if true.
From the person that I've talked to who has a direct line to Shad Khan, this question was asked. Why won't you get rid of Baalke? He doesn't want to have to go through the search for another general manager. That's what I've been told. To me, all due respect to Shad Khan, I respect what he does as a businessman. That is a lazy way to look at a situation. That's an apathetic way to look at a situation. That's being content with what you have instead of trying to build for better.
Like I said, that is very insulting if true. You're basically calling the owner of the Jaguars and a multi-billionaire lazy. I not sure lazy, even if that is the case, that he doesn't want to do a GM search right now. That he's got a guy who's been in there a couple of years. You know, Trent Baalke is sitting in a meeting with Shad Khan going over this year's draft class and is painting a different picture, right, than what many of us might paint. And even we admit that by the end of the year, the top of the draft class in particular was improving, looking like he could make a point. But they were awful in free agency last year. They just were. Nothing hit. Shaq Griffin's a nice player. They paid handsomely for it. But other than that, you know, Agnew was a throwaway. They got kind of lucky with a throwaway free agent signing. Give Daryl Bevel a lot of credit for that one, right, for knowing him from Detroit. And so well played by Bevel on that one. But other than that, I mean, that mishmash of defensive linemen were just guys. Rayshon Jenkins wasn't worth his money, at least in year one. Seems like a good leader, good locker room guy, and a good football player, but not a, hey, pay him rants, you know, top safety kind of money. Again, we looked over it when he went on IR. The passes defended and interception were what the impactful safeties, what he had all year. Impactful safeties get in a couple of weeks around the NFL. So anyway, Trent Baalke's resume here is far from complete, but it's not like it's off to some A-plus start. And again, it's pretty typical around the league. When you clean house, you clean house. You know, you don't go ahead and leave one room messy. Just clean it all. Try again. Winery, by the way, thinks the Byron left, which his former teammate thinks that deal is dead. Well, we'll keep you updated, though, on the hostage negotiations. Again, at last check, Trent Baalke threatening to start shooting if the helicopter doesn't arrive to get him the blank out of there. So there's that. Some days I get torn here in the morning. I'll think of, as I'm always doing, grinding on the show, gatekeeping to, you know, 24 hours to process. And sometimes I'll come across something that's so interesting to me, I want to just present it on its own, and I'm about to. But in doing so, I'm sacrificing what I think would have been a tremendous pop quiz for my friend and colleague Dan Hicken a little bit later in the morning.
Those are the tough choices.
But if I do it right now, see, I mean, I really, if I was going to do that and intend to do both, I needed to bust it right out about 6:05. But odds are that, you know, he's probably in the car by now. And so I'm going to give you this wow stat and tell you why I'm giving it to you. And if it means sacrificing an awesome pop quiz a little bit later, then, well, sacrifices have to be made. Tony Boselli's getting in the Hall of Fame, gang. I'm not going on inside information, something that we've been told. I really looked at the field, though, now. Took a good look at it that we're to this part of the process. And he is, I mean, he's head and shoulders the best candidate that's out there. It won't surprise me if Tony Boselli gets the highest percentage of the vote. Maybe DeMarcus Ware in his first year will draw that kind of attention. But I really feel more confident than ever that Tony Boselli is going to be the first Hall of Famer for the Jags. And what an attaboy. What a terrific accomplishment. Again, I'm very well aware of the mush. I don't like to jinx things, but I'm telling you, I feel it, right, that that's going to finally happen this year for Tony. It's opened up just so wide for him. Beef, do you have the list of those 15 that were remaining?
Hopefully.
All right, well, while you find that, let me tell you what that inspired out of me. I have now already accepted Tony Boselli into the Hall of Fame as the first Jaguar. And so I now start to wonder about the fates and fortunes of two other very prolific Jaguars players who are going to start getting their due in this process, I believe, now. Now, unfortunately, as we get a little further removed from their careers and their numbers continue to hold strong, okay? And we talk about Fred Taylor in that context, and we should, because, you know, Fred is still in the stat every single running back with more career yards than Fred Taylor is already in the Hall of Fame. It seems like it's a stat like that. I can't put you on 18 different stat. I can't put you on 18 different stat hunts, so I won't. Do you have the 15 finalists? Is that the thumbs up you gave?
Yeah.
So, yeah, give me the 15 finalists. So Boselli, who I've now put in the Hall of Fame, by the way.
Let's run through this. It's alphabetical.
Okay.
But here's your list.
Yeah.
Jared Allen.
Okay, worthy, but certainly going to have to be talked about a lot.
Longtime Bengals tackle Willie Anderson.
Not before Tony.
Rondae Barber.
Worthy of getting in, but certainly not wow.
Big Bo, as we've mentioned.
Yeah.
Leroy Butler, who we've often said deserves it.
Be rooting for him.
Absolutely. Devin Hester, wild card.
All right.
Torrey Holt, another Jaguar great.
Okay.
Andre Johnson, a thorn in our side.
First ballot, though, I'd say no.
Sam Mills?
Good player. Again, you can even stop. The point is, nobody just overwhelms you with, that guy's in.
The rest of the guys on the list, there's really, one guy kind of, glows as, this guy's probably getting in. You've got Richard Seymour, Zach Thomas, Reggie Wayne, Patrick Willis, Bryant Young, and DeMarcus Ware.
DeMarcus Ware
is probably going in.
And there's arguments for all those guys. That's why they're in the 15. But I'm saying that, to me, Boselli and Ware are the two that I would be comfortable saying those guys are in. Because Boselli's gotten so far in this process for how many years in a row, and now he's there above all these people he's been above, and the first-year class isn't going to overwhelm you with a Peyton Manning or a Tom Brady there to snag a spot. So I really think that he is in, okay? And now I'm going to drop this stat on you because, again, we focus a lot on Fred, and rightfully we should. We'll continue to, and Fred should get the call from the Hall. But I think Jimmy Smith is on to something. You know, he didn't go out with a hero's farewell, did he? Jimmy kind of got caught with his hand in the cookie jar. He had to have a kind of a clunky forced retirement. You know, it is what it is. Jimmy had his demons. But he was a hell of a football player here in Jacksonville. And I came across a stat, man, that I think screams Jimmy didn't get his due. Okay? Here's that stat. Who did you just, you said Reggie Wayne is on the list? And,
yeah, of the wideouts, Reggie Wayne, Torrey Holt, Andre Johnson. Those, okay. And I guess if you count Hester.
Okay, Torrey Holt. I'm not going to count Hester for the sake of this advertisement, or this segment. What am I saying? Advertisement. Torrey Holt, Andre Johnson, Reggie Wayne. Those three guys are all on the ballot, and rightfully so. Okay? Torrey Holt had 8,000-yard receiving seasons. I'm having a stroke. He had 8,000-yard seasons. He had 11,076 career yards. You got that? Torrey Holt, 8,000-yard receiving seasons, 11,076 career yards. Reggie Wayne, 8,000-yard receiving seasons, 10,204 career yards. Andre Johnson, just 7,000-yard receiving seasons, 9,654 yards. Wait for it. Jimmy Smith, 9,000-yard receiving seasons, 11,194 yards, more 1,000-yard seasons, and more total yards. In fact, 9,000-yard receiving seasons by Jimmy Smith is topped only by Jerry Rice and Randy Moss. Jimmy, in a, quote, logjam with only three other players who did that. And those three, ready? Tim Brown, Terrell Owens, and Larry Fitzgerald.
All slam dunkers.
Jimmy Smith's Hall of Fame case is just as strong as Fred's, if not stronger. And what's curious is why those three said receivers with less yards in production, less 1,000-yard seasons, shoot less receptions in some cases. Andre Johnson, fewer 1,000-yard receiving seasons, 1,500 fewer career yards, and 81 fewer catches, is a first-ballot Hall of Famer, and Jimmy just twisting the wind with receiving production numbers that are matched only by Hall of Famers. It's weird how we pick and choose. It's weird how we remember Reggie Wayne as being somehow more qualified for the Hall of Fame than Jimmy Smith when he has 1,000 fewer yards, 50 fewer catches, and one less 1,000-yard receiving seasons. There are only six receivers in NFL history with 9 or more 1,000-yard seasons. That would seem to be a real good barometer for a Hall of Famer, by the way. You want to talk about explosive production? It's a 1,000-yard season. Even with the 16 games, it's a measuring stick. It's a yard mark. Only Jerry Rice and Randy Moss have more 1,000-yard receiving seasons than Jimmy Smith. Isn't that something? So, never mind the pop quiz. That's a Daily's double take. We need a double take at Jimmy Smith's productive, Hall of Fame worthy statistical career and ask a question why Torrey Holt, Reggie Wayne, and Andre Johnson, with less production as NFL players, are all on the ballot, and Jimmy didn't even make the 25. This is the drill. That's a Daily's Double Take, brought to you by the Daily's Dash and the deliciousness that awaits you this morning for breakfast. Pile those biscuits high, buddy. Getting a good deal, the freshest ingredients, a chicken sandwich, and the spicy chicken now available at the San Jose Boulevard location, and it'll be popping up at others. The Dash is for real, man. Discover it yourself. It's the Daily's Double Take, brought to you by the Daily's Dash. Got a football fix. Interesting comments yesterday, I thought, from a pair of guys that worked together for a long, long time, Tom Brady and Josh McDaniels. Next on the drill. All right, back here on the drill. I mentioned earlier Florida State going to play on a Friday night, the Friday after Thanksgiving. Which is where the middling 7-6 programs go off to claim national spotlight. They've been promised, quote, a primetime spot. Friday. That's what FSU Florida now, a Friday game.
Under the Friday Night Lights.
By the way, hey, FSU Florida, I mean, don't worry about high school season at all either. I mean, don't worry about stomping on, like, regional finals or wherever we are at that point. You know, that's a reason, the biggest reason you don't play football on Friday, particularly in a talent-rich state like Florida. You don't want to interfere and stomp on the high school product, so I guess they'll decide to do that. FSU's schedule released yesterday. It includes a couple of marquee items. They're going to play their earliest ever game at Doak Campbell Stadium. The opener will be August 27th against a program I literally did not know played football. I know this as a basketball school, Duquesne. Apparently Duquesne has a football program. They'll be in Tallahassee to open the season. And then the next week, Labor Day weekend, FSU has a nice one with LSU that Sunday night. The week before the NFL season kicks off, that'll be at the Superdome. So there's that Sunday night game. Later in the year, they'll play a Friday game at Louisville. And then, like I said, the season finale is going to be scheduled on a Friday. Second time Florida and Florida State have played on a Friday. The last time was a good news for FSU. It was 1979. They beat the Gators in Gainesville and went 11-0 and off to the Orange Bowl to face Oklahoma. Be fire at the band. We got a football fix. Let me give you some news and notes from the National Football League. Both the Super Bowl teams are concerned about the situations at tight end. We saw both Uzomah and Higbee for the Bengals and Rams both go down now. Higbee, they say, out in Los Angeles. Tyler Higbee will very well likely miss the Super Bowl. He has an MCL sprain there. They are hopeful, but his status is at the very least up in the air. Meanwhile, the Bengals are encouraged by initial tests on CJ Uzomah. Man, he got carted off. When you see a guy get carted off, you don't see them again, but apparently he has that sprained MCL, the same sprained MCL that Higbee has. So a couple of names, the tight end position to keep in mind on the injury report as we move toward the big game. Credit to Cincinnati. And a lot of focus these days on education, you know, how the kids are being handled through the coronavirus and otherwise, but credit Cincinnati for really seeing what's most important, and that is when your city is in the Super Bowl, the Monday after the Super Bowl, no school. Yeah. We're either celebrating a Bengals Super Bowl or we're just in a depressive funk over the Bengals loss, but no school, kids.
That's punishment for the parents who were thinking about taking off Monday.
Yeah, right? Thought they were going to have it all to themselves.
Just put I'm going to get hammered watching the Super Bowl. I'm going to drop these kids off and go home and take a nap.
Just put them on the bus. Just put them on the bus. We'll be fine. Russell Wilson and Kirk Cousins are into the Pro Bowl in place of Tom Brady and Aaron Rodgers. I saw Brady has been named to like 15 Pro Bowls and he's played in two. Now, granted, in fairness, he's in the Super Bowl all the daggum time, isn't he? All right, that takes us to Brady. Brady has podcasts. I think what's happened here is that the narrative has gotten away from Brady. It's stolen an announcement that should have been his or his alone. So now I think he's just kind of throwing out some, well, we're still treading water. We haven't made a decision. When, in fact, the initial reports are probably right. He probably has made the decision. But I think now he wants to at least step back and say, well, it'll be time when I say it's time. Said on his podcast, he's, quote, still going through the process and hasn't decided when to announce his plans. Sometimes it takes some time to really evaluate how you feel and what you want to do. I think when the time's right, I'll be ready to make a decision one way or another, just like I said last week. When asked if he had a timeline, quote, I don't know. I'll know when the time is right. Like I've always said, I'm very blessed to play as long as I have. As things have gone on in the later parts of my career, there's a lot of interest in when I'm going to stop playing. I understand that. When I know, I'll know. When I don't know, I don't know. I'm not going to race to some conclusion about that. So whether or not the reports really did jump the gun and he hasn't made a decision, maybe at one point he was really leaning hard that way, but will change his mind. Tom Brady is going to do the rational thing here and let things settle. Now, there is a nuance here that it could make for a bad look for Tom Brady. If he stays with the team like past February 4th, I think is the date, he gets a $15 million bonus. Now, look, the Bucs owe him that and more for winning him a Super Bowl. But if you know all along you're going to play and you, quote, wait to make your announcement until after that $15 million pay bonus is triggered, yeah, I don't know about that one. We'll see. Tom Brady spent a lot of time with Josh McDaniels. McDaniels, if you don't remember, when he got the job in Denver and he left New England as offensive coordinator, went to Denver to be their head coach, do you remember he got off to that crazy 6-0 start? He started 6-0, ultimately ended sub-500 and was released, ultimately back to New England with his tail between his legs. McDaniels yesterday introduced as the Raiders' new head coach, admitted he wasn't ready for the position the first time around. That was more than 10 years ago, by the way. When I went to Denver, I knew a little bit of football, McDaniels said. I didn't really know people and how important that aspect of this process and maintaining the culture and building the team was. I failed, and I didn't succeed at it. Sounds like Urban Meyer and his foray into the league here. Looking at the experience, it's been one of the best things in my life in terms of my overall growth. Now, what I need to do different, how I need to handle my role. If I have another opportunity, went on to call the Raiders, you know, a premier job. Meanwhile, Matt Eberflus was introduced in Chicago and, you know, like many of these new coaches did, committed to a narrative that his team will play with passion and enthusiasm and camaraderie, and there'll be candor in the locker room, and a culture will be vitally important. Isn't it always? That's Football Fix. You're welcome. Hick and Arrival and more come your way next. This is The Drill on 1010 XL.
Ladies and gents, please put your hands together as Dan Hicken enters the studio.
Everybody, Super Tuesday.
Let's get out there. Rock that vote.
You've got to rock the vote.
Who will be the next interview for the position? Cast your vote now.
No telling. We'll get a name. Doug Peterson. Apparently
round
rocking
two.
And rolling today.
Dougie P, round two.
You just give him the job today and move on. Is that what you do?
I think we're all just... Thank
people
for
would be
resolution.
Pretty happy with that, to be honest.
Doug Peterson had a birthday yesterday.
Good for him.
54 years old. Is it time? In fact, there's one problem with hiring Doug Peterson, and that's keeping Balky. That's what's got the fans still in a tizzy. Our one-to-one financial poll question today: how would you feel about Doug Peterson as the team's next head coach? Hire him tomorrow. Rather have Leftwich. Just get us a coach now, or no thanks.
That's an interesting.
Yeah, 1,000 votes are in. Boys,
I would say it's probably slight edge Leftwich followed by Peterson.
Rather have Leftwich 41.9. Hire him tomorrow, 35.6.
There you go.
Just get us a coach now, 13.9. No thanks, 8.6.
No thanks. I just get us a coach now. I don't like that theory.
Yeah.
That implies whoever.
Yeah.
Saatchi, assign him.
Well, there is. And again, if I put who cares in there again, it would have won. I mean, that's
yeah.
where people are.
No, that's
fair. I mean,
fair.
I get to a point, but you still, I mean, it just depends what happens, you know? And again, it looks like, reading all these names, Kevin O'Connell, are they willing to wait? Will he get the Vikings job? Doug Peterson now, Rich Bisaccia. So whatever happened with Byron happened with Byron, and it was probably as reported, speculated, thought of, is that, you know, he didn't want to work with Balke, and so he said no thanks.
I wonder, does he get
that?
Which
is what a lot of people thought Peterson said originally.
I wonder if that's because of how the interview went with Balke and his engagement with him, or and what was said in the meeting about how the GM, no matter who it was, would be.
I suspect it was probably a private meeting afterwards.
Yeah, but no. Not when did he tell him? Mm-hmm. When did he decide that he didn't want to work with Balke?
Oh.
From his interactions with him personally, or from this seeming, you know, blanket narrative around the league about how hard it is to work with him.
Or did he, yeah.
That's
did
what
he
I
get
want
that
to
word from his mentors.
Right. That's what I want to know. Yeah.
Don't take that job. It's not worth it.
Yeah. And if that's the case, then that's, I don't know if that's
again,
fair.
For Byron Leftwich, right. But we don't know that. So I don't want to disparage Byron on that. But for Byron Leftwich.
That's a curiosity to me to know.
Yeah. And we've talked about this, obviously. There's only 32 jobs. And this is the one that he got most far along in. And so, you got to weigh the pros and the cons, but again, if Brady does retire, and all indications that Brady retires, Byron Leftwich, I don't suspect the Bucs continue to wow us, and I don't know where Byron then falls. It's here today, gone tomorrow. These coaching candidates, they rise up, they disappear. They rise up, they disappear. People say, whatever happened to, you know, Byron in 2 or 3 years? Say Arians retires. Byron doesn't.
It happens,
get,
yeah.
And all of a sudden you're left in, you know, Eric Bieniemy is a perfect example.
Byron should have taken this job. He had Trevor Lawrence. He could have worked with him. He's got a franchise quarterback. He's got the number one pick.
Yeah.
And your first opportunity. Like, I'm not saying this because it's Byron. I would say this about any assistant coming over. You learn that lesson with Urban.
Yeah.
I'm not giving a guy who's that much power who's not had this kind of job before.
Right.
You know, being the offensive coordinator for an offensive mind and a successful coach like Bruce Arians and a quarterback like Tom Brady, you know, I mean, a lot of vetting there. I can't just turn over all of that to whoever that,
right.
You know, that could have been Josh McDaniels. I would have said the same thing.
Yeah. So it'll be interesting going forward. Speaking of Josh McDaniels, he had his introductory press conference with the Raiders. See, that's what's frustrating for fans too. I mean, these guys are all been introduced, are off to the races, they're working, and we're idling along here with guys like DJ Chark out there, not knowing what he's, you know, his situation. I mean, we gotta make some decisions.
Well,
Senior Bowl practices underway. I mean, it's just, we should be talking about Senior Bowl and stuff, not waiting for a coach at this point. It's been long enough. They've had plenty of time. We're now into February.
Oh, it's ridiculous. We characterized it this morning with a little fun with audio with the hidden microphones down there. It feels like a hostage situation at this point.
Yeah.
It feels like Trent Baalke's. They're holding the building hostage with, you know, bundles of TNT and semi-automatic weapons.
I was thinking of this morning. The NFL is such a – well, think about the NFL. It's a copycat league, right? Somebody's success, like the Jags tried it a couple times. If you look back in their history by adding R.J. Sauer, we have three great receivers.
Like
the Rams did.
Hakeem was the guy back then.
Right. So there's that, and then there's – and then there's the big gigantic defensive tackles like the Ravens had Goose and Sam Adams, right? So we had Henderson and Stroud. And we're, I mean, to a point, but the idea is to win a Super Bowl. So to me, the latest rage will be trade for a guy like Matthew Stafford, win a Super Bowl. Because this offseason, there'll be guys to trade for. So I'm wondering if teams will give up even more. Like if I had a franchise guy, first off, I would never trade my franchise quarterback. But clearly, Deshaun Watson is going to leave. I think Russell Wilson probably will leave. I don't know if Aaron Rodgers will or not. My thought is he ends up staying, but perhaps he leaves. So I wonder if teams like, you know, Philadelphia or
Pittsburgh.
You know, Pittsburgh. You know, all we need is that, you know.
Houston.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, not the, all they need is
right.
that with them. But
right. So.
Well, there's a bunch of, there's a few teams out there. But the Colts could be a team like that.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, the only thing is the
so
difference
I wonder
is,
if that will happen this offseason more.
I don't know because the next step in that process hasn't happened yet. And that step is contenders trading away franchise quarterbacks. It's very rare that a franchise quarterback is on a bad team. His talent usually makes that team good enough
right.
that they're never going to trade him.
Right.
Whereas so Matthew Stafford was in that rare situation where he was seemed to be a franchise quarterback, but whose team and organization
right.
he couldn't thrive under. So like if Aaron Rodgers goes, and I'm talking about outside of free agency.
Yeah.
Free agency is one thing. I mean, you can always get a guy that you may think is, some may think is done there. But I'm still waiting on a franchise quarterback to be traded by a contender.
Yeah.
I don't know if Seattle is that anymore.
What is Lions brass thinking? Like, they had a new coach and GM come in, and, you know, it was a feel-good story when it happened. And, you know, Stafford ran into McVay and Cabo and, you know, beautiful people, beautiful women. Hey, man.
I forgot how early in the calendar year that happened. Like, we've already had the anniversary of that signing.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, that happened in January.
So, you know, it was like I said, it's a feel-good story that happens and everything. And there goes Matthew Stafford, and Detroit got Goff, and Detroit's the worst for it in a way. Like, do you wonder, like, I like Campbell, and I like the group they have there. They all seem to be on the same page. They battled, you know, they were terrible this year, but I think eventually they'll be good. But if they languish without a quarterback for the next 5 to 10 years, then it's a terrible trade, right? You got to find that guy.
I guess the difference is
would you rather be the Lions without or be a team who you think you have or the Jaguars who have Trevor Lawrence and nothing else? Which would you rather be? I'd rather be the Jaguars.
Well, again, it only took 1 year, but we're rubber meets road on Trevor Lawrence. Can't keep dangling this prospect of a franchise quarterback without the productive year. So right now,
we're not rubber meets road, but yeah, I know what you're saying. The rubber doesn't have to hit the road this year, but he has to be better.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
I mean,
but
by some measure.
Which would you rather have? Would you rather have a guy you think is a franchise quarterback, which I think we do, or would you rather be the Lions?
Well, the Lions are terrible, and they don't have either, so I'd rather be us.
Yeah.
Would you rather be a bad team with a potential franchise quarterback? That's the question.
The problem is the Lions seemingly have other good things. Like, they like their coach. They like their GM. They like their structure.
I mean, they can like them all they want. They were nothing special.
We're a dysfunctional mess.
Jared Goff is – if the Lions were good, they'd be – Jared Goff is not a bad quarterback.
No, he's not, but he's not.
I mean, he's not. He's
but
not,
he's in a bad spot because the poor guy got exiled to Detroit and, you know.
67% of his passes, 19 touchdowns, 8 picks, passer rating 91. I mean, you know, not great, but certainly.
And called out by his coach during the year.
Better, more passing yards than Jalen Hurts, Russell Wilson, Baker Mayfield, Lamar Jackson, Tua. I mean, on a terrible team. And you want to talk about weapons. Who's that guy throwing to?
Yeah.
I mean, he developed that Amroz St. Brown. Is that his name?
Yeah.
So, but you know, he's not. Stafford, obviously. But if you're the Lions, here's what happens. You keep Stafford, you win 5 last year instead of 2 or 3. Ooh. But they got a hit. What did they get for him? Did they get first rounders? I don't even know what the trade was exactly. I don't remember. Do you remember what they have in return? Did they get it last draft? Like, when do they get the payoff for the trade? I mean, certainly it was more than Goff.
Oh, yeah. It was picks.
Yeah, but was it first or third? Did they even have to give up a first rounder?
Yeah, 2 first rounders.
Last year and this year, or this year and next year?
Let me look.
It's hard to recall, you know, a team like Detroit's draft. I know they had that pick near the top.
Yeah.
So, and the Rams would have picked, you know, more toward the bottom. But I don't remember a second first-round pick for the Lions last year, so I'm just curious if it's this year. Point being, you better make those draft picks hit. You know, the Rams keep trading draft picks that don't materialize.
Well, they get the 2022 first-round pick, but it might be 32nd.
It might be, yeah. But it's still an added playmaker or talent.
The second first-rounder they get comes in 2023.
Yeah, so it's spread out a little bit.
Yeah.
Probably because the Rams have already traded the other ones.
Yeah, I mean, the Rams don't have a first-round pick till 2024.
Right. And you know what?
But who cares?
They are. You know, it's funny. When we were kids, there was an NFL team that the first Washington. One that did this was Washington. Yeah. Did it all in free
George
agency.
Allen, the old, yeah, over the yeah. hill gang.
Over the hill gang. That was their nickname. They would just go get these free agents every year and just keep rolling them out and rolling them out.
And it worked.
It worked.
Yeah. And old Billy Kilmer and Sonny Jurgensen at quarterback.
Who was Theismann after Kilmer, or was there a gap?
Probably was.
You know, maybe there was like somebody in there for a cup of coffee that I don't remember, but.
Well, maybe, but yeah.
But Kilmer was into the mid-70s, and then Theismann was like.
Billy Kilmer was old, man.
He was an old.
Old, crusty.
He looked like.
Cigarette smoking.
Yeah, he looked
whether
like.
Whether he did or didn't, who
right,
knows.
He looked like he would do shots like in between plays or something.
Yeah.
I mean, I think of Billy Kilmer, I think of like a drinker's nose and a. This dude literally would run like.
Billy Kilmer went till 77, was still with him in. No, 78.
And
it was Theismann. Theismann came along in 76.
So it was Theismann.
So it was Kilmer 9, Theismann 5, Kilmer 8, Theismann 6, 78,
starts.
Kilmer 14. Yeah, Kilmer 2. So Theismann took over really in 78. And then what was interesting was there was a cat in 75, a backup guy named Randy Johnson who started too. Do you remember him?
I remember him because he was an Atlanta Falcon.
Yeah, Randy Johnson.
But Johnson played for the Falcons before then, I think.
And
early
Sonny 70s. Was the 60s, and then really Kilmer was the 70s with Sonny as the backup. Sonny had 4 years where he started 1, 4, 4, and 4 games in the 70s.
For Washington?
For Washington.
So Kilmer was the guy. When I was a kid, it was Kilmer pretty
then
much
after
every
Theismann
year.
Then after Theismann came Schrader, then Doug, then the Ripper and Doug.
But like the Redskins team that went to the Super Bowl against the Dolphins, that was Kilmer.
The 14-7 game?
Yeah.
The 72 game? Yeah, that was Kilmer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He was that entire – now,
yeah.
again, I'm a young kid.
Yeah.
But yeah. I can remember – when I remember – what I but and they had one of the Redskins back in the day – or you know, Washington back in the day had one of the most memorable names of my childhood. They had a player who, to me, had the most memorable name. Of course, I didn't accurately pronounce his name. I always – but that Chris Hamburger, remember?
Yes.
The linebacker. Hamburger. I mean, that guy.
I think he's number 55.
Yeah, that name stuck out. He was a good player, too,
Chris Hamburger. They also had the dancing bear, Ron McDowell.
I don't remember him.
You don't remember Ron McDowell? Yeah. I think he played at Buffalo, too, but Ron McDowell was called the dancing bear. Great nickname. That's why I remember him.
The Hogs came along after that in the 80s.
Yeah, but the over
the fun bunch. I mean, they had a lot of.
Great tradition.
Washington's had a great tradition, man. They've really gone in the tank under Snyder, right? I mean, up until Snyder, it was a Jack Kent Cook was their
Jack
owner.
Jack Pardee was on those teams.
Yeah.
Right?
No, I don't remember him as a player.
Yeah.
I remember him as a coach almost exclusively.
Yeah. Did you
cherry pick? Were you, as you always are, I mean, busting up that Arbitron number, listening to the show when I had that list of 1,000-yard receiving seasons?
No.
You don't know what I'm talking about?
Uh-uh.
You have no idea?
Mm-mm.
Pop quiz music, please, Beef.
Okay.
We'll come back. We'll do ETN if anyone wants to play along this week.
We'd
love
judge.
It if they did.
Yeah.
Well, I started formulating in my head because I'm, you know, dead certain. Looking at this cast of candidates, that we're going to finally get that Hall of Famer. I think Tony will break through. Don't you think so?
Yeah, said it since last year.
And plus, you look now, and I really now look and contemplate these 15 names they just bandied about. Tony, to me, and not just based on our friendship, our relationship, and the Jaguar ties, stands above those guys to me. And plus, he's been in
position.
Anyway, just assuming that he's going to get in.
It all lines up for him.
It certainly seems like it. I mean, every indication to me would point in that direction.
Mm-hmm.
So then I start naturally thinking, all right, who are we getting in next? And we've been big on Fred and where he stands nationally.
Yes. I've talked about Fred for a long time.
Right. Mm-hmm. And to the point that it's been stated, I think, by many that Fred would be the next best chance for the Jaguars as a Hall of Famer.
Yeah, he's also moved up the chain.
Yeah. And then I did a little research, and the results shocked me. So, Beef Pop Quiz music, please.
Okay.
Whoa!
All right.
That's what we're doing.
I'm not afraid.
It's happening. Buckle up.
Hey. Only 6 receivers in the history of the National Football League have 9,000-yard receiving seasons or more.
Yeah.
Only 6.
Okay.
Who are the 6?
Jerry Rice.
Jerry Rice is number 1. He has 14,000-yard receiving seasons.
Randy Moss.
Randy Moss has 10,000-yard receiving. They're the only 2 in double digits. There are 4 other players that had 9,000-yard receiving seasons.
T.O.?
T.O. had 9. And 11,149 yards.
I'm going to context clue it.
Yeah.
and say Jay Smooth.
Jimmy Smith has 9.
Yes. And
the game can end. It doesn't matter. Yeah. It's proving my point.
Yeah.
Jimmy Smith's Hall of Fame candidacy has been, I don't know what the hell's going on. And let me just give you one more example. We'll keep it timely.
Mm-hmm.
There are 3 receivers, Dan Hicken, that have advanced to the finalist stage this year.
Yeah.
Still alive. Those 3 receivers are Reggie Wayne, Torrey Holt, and Andre Johnson.
Mm-hmm.
Andre Johnson, first year on the ballot. Let's do a little quick comparison.
Yeah.
Jimmy Smith had 9,000-yard receiving seasons. Andre Johnson had 7. Jimmy Smith had 11,100 receiving yards, 200 receiving yards. Andre Johnson had 9,600. Mm-hmm. Jimmy Smith had 60 touchdowns. Andre Johnson had 45. Tell me why Andre Johnson is a first ballot Hall of Fame finalist. And Jimmy, by the way, Jimmy Smith has more 1,000-yard seasons than Torrey Holt and Reggie Wayne.
Yeah.
He also has more yards than Torrey Holt and Reggie Wayne.
Mm-hmm.
And he dwarfs Andre Johnson, who's in his first year, at least in this process. And yet he gets not even into the 25.
Well, he should be in the discussion. We've always said
but
that.
But not even in the 25.
Yeah.
So, I would be real curious to know how and why those 3 receivers, who, by the way, 2 of them had the benefit of Hall of Famers on the other side, and they got the slappy corner who doesn't lock down the best receiver. Jimmy was drawing the best of the best every single week.
Mm-hmm.
I'm surprised to see how well he stacks up. He stacks up better statistically than I thought and could very well lay his own claim to he should be next when it comes to the Jaguars' history, football-wise.
Yeah.
But the fact that there are only 6 receivers, 5 of them are Hall of Famers, and then there's Jimmy, who have that many 1,000-yard receiving seasons.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that he has more receiving yards than Tim Brown or Reggie Wayne or Steve Smith or Torrey Holt or Marvin. He's got the same as Marvin Harrison, basically, and more 1,000-yard receiving seasons than Harrison. I don't know. That would be it. If I were ever arguing for Jimmy Smith, that's what I would take.
Yeah, I think they're looking at, and again, I can't speak for them at all. I'm wondering if they're, you know, 1,000 catches, you know, those types of things. I don't know.
Jim, my point is, I don't think you could find a stat where Andre Johnson, Torrey Holt, and Reggie Wayne have better stats than Jimmy. Not a single category. Not in catches, yards, touchdowns, 1,000-yard seasons. And so it's not the argument that, well, it should be Jimmy instead of them. It's just a curiosity.
Look, I'm all for Jimmy
Smith.
It's
just a curiosity to me how those 3 are viewed in that.
Well, Andre Johnson has 1,000 receptions, right?
He's got 705, no? Or is this an old list?
He has 1,062.
Okay. All right, well, I got an old list.
So. Yeah,
shame on me. That's an old list. Who are?
Yeah.
Do we still, though, have maybe he got up to 9.
Reggie Wayne has 1,070.
And Jimmy has?
Jimmy's down
786. Is that what he's at or
eight,
more?
Yeah,
this is an old list.
862.
The list is old.
Okay.
My bad.
But, I mean, your point is valid.
Yeah, no.
9,000-yard seasons, et cetera.
It's less valid with.
Yeah.
Although he still had the 9,000-yard receiving seasons is still accurate.
Yes. Yes. 100%.
But some, like, Torrey Holt does have, you know, 1,100 more. No, 1,000 more receiving yards than Jimmy.
Yeah.
And Reggie Wayne has more receiving yards. He does have, though, the 1,000-yard receiving stat is still valid.
1,000 is like the magic number. Like, what about Hines Ward? Will he get into the Pro Football Hall of Fame?
To me, he feels like a Hall of Famer.
See, I think Jimmy Smith was a better receiver than Hines Ward by far, but not by far, but a better receiver. But Hines Ward has the Pittsburgh Steelers and we're the Jags. And so I think there's a progression here, but I think Jimmy at some point's name should absolutely come up and be discussed. I've always said that. And just like with
Hines Ward,
quite honestly,
Hines Ward didn't even have 4,000-yard seasons.
Yeah.
Not even 4. Yeah. I don't know. 4. The list ends at 4. Tony Gonzalez, Andre Reed.
But, Jimmy is right next to Mohsin Muhammad and Irving Fryer and Keenan and those guys. So it's we got to go. We're up against it. It's a great debate, though.
Yeah, we'll do ETN.
We'll do more today.
Yeah, ETN.
All right,
guess
Guggen Judge, 641-1010.
Saqib, good news for you. Saqib is the judge. We'll be back with more next.
All right.
We heard your cries, Guggen Nation, but too much of a good thing is bad for your health. So we're only doing this once a week. Buckle up, baby. It's time for ETN. Brought to you by All Pro Roofing on 1010XL.
Oh, there it is. That's our cue. Like Pavlov's dog. Our mouths are watering. Our old friend Saqib is back from banishment. I don't know where he'd been.
I like Saqib in this respect.
Okay.
He's like always when I'm driving home from the stadium.
Mm-hmm.
Saqib, tell me if I'm wrong here, and welcome to the show. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Tell me if I'm wrong. When I'm driving home from the stadium, I'm always listening to the talk shows. And Saqib is always like the first caller
Saqib
on.
Saqib from the South Side.
Yes. Yeah. And always, and sadly, Saqib. It's usually an emotional, hateful rant because we usually have lost the game.
That's fair.
I look forward to hearing one day, I hope, happy Saqib, joyful Saqib. We're on a roll, guys. This is great, man.
Hey, Dan, are you going to suck up to me to win the game? Or
it sounds like it.
100%.
That's what it seems like.
Point out how my not. Well, maybe.
The timing's curious.
You're probably right.
Saqib, for his efforts today, which we appreciate, is going to go home.
Saw right through me.
$25 gift certificate to Famous Automotive and Quick Lube. You can use that towards an oil change or any other service.
All right.
Shall we dance?
Let's go.
Let's crank it up.
Saqib's ready.
Round one.
He knows how it works. Round one.
Can I real quickly just drop this in? It just came in on the text line, but
yes,
a speed trap there at Heckscher at the bottom of the Dames Point. So
I
don't even need any music, but if y'all are traveling that way, keep the speeds down, keep that cash.
That's a steep slope. You can get cooking down that hill.
That bridge kind of freaks me out a little bit. I'm not going
to
lie.
Every time I have to go over that bridge, like in the radio station van, it's terrifying.
Like there are people that have those full blown bridge phobias. We've talked about that before. Like they won't go over bridges.
Yeah.
And I'm tiptoeing into that neurosis just a little bit. Like, I'll never, like, pull over and refuse to go over a bridge, but I don't necessarily like them either.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, that van, when you get over that Damesport, it's like a sail. Round one, we have another name. Well, not a new name, but a second visit for Doug Peters. Another name added to this seeming second batch of coaching candidates as, I guess, we bid farewell to the Byron ship. And we start coaching search phase two.
Never say never, Beef.
Never say never, I guess.
Especially with these guys in this situation.
It seems like we're also waiting until after the Super Bowl to possibly talk to Kevin O'Connell. So I guess my question is, will we have a coach before we get to that date, to Feb 13, or will this carry on beyond the Super Bowl?
All right, I have a question. Is Trent Baalke armed or unarmed?
Locked and loaded.
Yeah, if he's armed, it may be after the Super Bowl as he digs himself in the trenches between two filing cabinets and just unleashes a hail of gunfire on anyone who threatens the throne. I mean, look, after the Super Bowl, drag it on two more weeks? I can't imagine. I mean, at some point, the NFL calendar year is going to reset. You're going to have to do something. So I would like – you know what I really think? That somehow or another, Peterson is going to have to be named tomorrow. I mean, hey, we've done 12 guys for Pete's sakes.
Shod, NFL PR on line one. Okay. Hello. Yeah, Mr. Khan, listen, this is NFL PR. It's spring break. We really need to know who your coach is going to be. We're having the meetings, and we've got to put all the pictures of the head coaches out on our public relations media guide. Could you help us out here? Gee whiz. Listen, it is what it is at this point. I'm like a Jag fan in this respect. Just name a guy. I'm apathetic at this point. We've gone through so many names and so many opinions and so many yeses and so many nos. Just pick one and let's play the do theory like I've been saying all along and hopefully close our eyes, throw one at the dartboard and somehow it sticks in the middle.
It works.
Let's go.
You know, I'm at this point same as you, Dan. I just want to coach, man. It's a horrible thing, and I'll give you that point, buddy.
Thank you.
Round two.
Round two. Meanwhile, yesterday on Dan Hicken's 100% favorite show here on the Superstation, he calls it the Lunch Bunch.
Yes.
They were visited by former Jaguar offensive lineman Uche Nwaneri, who had many things to say, including a fairly damning condemnation of Shad Khan as it pertains to the retention of Trent Baalke. I brought a clip.
From the person that I've talked to who has the direct line to Shad Khan, this question was asked. Why won't you get rid of Baalke? He doesn't want to have to go through the search for another general manager. That's what I've been told. To me, all due respect to Shad Khan, I respect what he does as a businessman. That is a lazy way to look at a situation. That's an apathetic way to look at the situation. That's being content with what you have instead of trying to build for better.
Do you think there's
credence
to that?
Uche and Saqib have the same phone, so they got that going for them.
Do you think there's any credence to the notion that it's just a lack of desire to do a mass search for both a coach and a GM?
No, I don't think there's any credence to that. But I do think that Shad Khan has so many different business interests that, you know, sometimes things get dragged out longer than they should. In other words, you know, we need to interview so-and-so. Like, if you go and read Ryan O'Halloran's 19 Days of the Broncos search, it's like bang, 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 bang. I don't know if the Jaguars are going bang, 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 bang. It might be, well, I got to do this. I got a meeting in Brussels on Wednesday so I could do it on Thursday. You know, I don't know. So I think that – I think we still would be. I think the best model for the Jaguars still, I definitely am convinced of this, would be if Shad Khan had a right-hand football man here who could handle everything and then report to Shad when need be.
Well, I'll take disagreement with what you said and with what Uche said. And I don't think that Shad hasn't changed GMs because he's worried about a flex gate or a hotel development meeting. I think that he is just wary. Look, one thing he did last year is he went, we're going to be a coach strong organization. Well, it was an absolute disaster. And he looks at Trent Baalke, I'm sure, at this stage as they try and find the head coach to give like the organization some sort of stability. I think he's wrong in this. You know, I don't think it's the stability he thinks he's getting, but I think that's why he's staying with a GM to help get the search, to get a coach name in place. And then, you know what? Happens all the time. A guy comes in for a year, and after a year, maybe they change GMs next year, and your coach has more of a say in how you move the organization forward. So I would put it more on that than – it's certainly not laziness. I mean, to call Shad Khan lazy, I think, is lazy.
I agree with you, Prosser.
Round three.
Yesterday, a just universally well-received announcement on the college football front as Florida State revealed their schedule – and it included a bit of a shift for the annual Florida State matchup, as instead of a Saturday night affair or Saturday afternoon affair, it instead will be Black Friday. So I guess I'll toss it to you guys. How you feel about Florida State on Black Friday?
Yeah, that's all. What are we, Iowa State now? Is that what are we, TCU, SMU, a Friday night game? You mean where you dump two teams to fulfill the conference's legal contract, but nobody's really interested? Yeah, this is a 100% indictment of where Florida and Florida State football is right now. And the fact that they would even agree to – and by the way, very poor form to go stomping on high school regionals. I mean, we're deep into the high school playoff season, so to take that out of play as well, I don't like it. I don't like gimmicks for two programs that have claimed a lot of national titles in the last 30 years. And I feel now like it's, you know, Iowa-Nebraska 2:30 on Friday.
Yeah, it's disappointing as heck, but it's all on the Gators and the Noles for being bad, crappy teams. You know, hey, if one of you is good, it would have stayed on Saturday because TV wants it on Saturday. But listen, we got to fill slots. Okay, this is not a bad. We joke every year. Where's Florida State going to be? On the Home Garden Network. Where's Florida State going to be? It's on E this. Where's Florida State going to be? Who cares? I mean, so. Listen, the situation is this. Blame whoever you want, but it's Florida State's fault. Get good again and get the dadgum game off Friday nights.
First of all, I'm a Florida State fan. I disagree 100% with both of you guys say all the time, but Friday is horrible. We want Saturday games. That's both of those games. I'll give it to Jeff Prosser.
Round four.
Coming up today, I'm sorry, tomorrow, I should say.
By the way, I think there's some thought out there that maybe it's to like help promote the ACC network, and that makes it even worse. Let's put it on a Friday night invisible network where you won't even catch it by accident if you're sitting in Tullahoma, Tennessee.
What up, Tullahoma?
All calls.
Tomorrow, Wednesday,
what
is
just happened? We shifted.
We love it. Tomorrow we like to call it NSD. Right,
yes.
National side. A
yes.
Huge day for college football coaches, right?
Yes.
A massive day if you're a college football
except
coach.
Except for one.
All eyes on the prize, right? Yeah. Unless you're Jim Harbaugh,
yeah,
who's going to be in Minnesota talking to the Vikings. Is that the biggest indicator that
yes,
he's done?
Yes. I mean, there's no what are we doing? You cannot leave. You know, do it today. Do it Thursday. Do it Friday. I mean, Coach, I'm not sure. I mean, I'm on the bubble. I'm trying to reach Coach Harbaugh. I'm on the bubble. I really want to come to Michigan, but I've also got Ohio State here asking me to come play for them, and I know who the coach is. Coach, hello. Coach is busy right now. He's talking with the Vikings. What? I mean,
I keep calling coaches, yeah, going straight to voicemail.
Hasta la vista, Jim. Good luck in the NFL. I mean, there's no other. You can't explain this one.
I'm depressed if I'm a Michigan fan. I mean, forget Harbaugh to the Vikings. That's a no-brainer for the Vikings. Harbaugh took a team to the Super Bowl, and if it weren't for a head-butting session with our GM here, Trent Baalke, who knows where that NFL career would have gone and stayed. Of course, Harbaugh had the brother-brother matchup in the Super Bowl. That was fantastic years ago. But to me, no, this is just a huge indictment of what Michigan is moving forward. If you can't win with Jim Harbaugh, and I think Harbaugh now finally, after making the playoff this year, waxed Ohio State and then just didn't even compete with Georgia. And so do you want to keep doing this if you're Jim Harbaugh? You want to go to the NFL, make just as much money, try and win a Super Bowl? And so if you're Michigan and you're a Michigan fan, you're left. Do you even care who the coach is? If Jim Harbaugh can't win with that notoriety that he brought, the early success on the recruiting trail and all the attention, and it's, by the way, the fact that he's a great coach and the fact that he was more successful at Stanford than Michigan tells you, if you're a Michigan fan, we're just going to have something magical happen once every 50 years.
We go into round five. How about that?
We're going to round five.
Welcome to round five and prepare to die.
Hey, I always hate when they drop that one in.
That was real.
That's rich.
It just got real. Lastly.
Don't forget, guys. Just prop me up in the corner. I'll keep eye on you.
Thank you, friend. We love you,
eternity.
Buddy.
Appreciate
you can
that.
Stuff me like
we'll
a taxidermed.
We'll decorate you for holidays.
Like a taxidermed possum. Yeah. I don't
I'll
care.
I'll high five you every morning.
I mean, my soul has gone onto a better place. You want to put my shell there for inspiration? Go ahead.
When we're mad, we'll put a little jar of mayonnaise in your
sometimes
hand.
Sometimes I'll come by and slap you.
Go ahead. Right. I can't feel it.
A big punch in the
face. Moved on.
I've wanted to do this for years.
I've moved on. That's where I'll be here in about 4 minutes. Yeah. Right there in a bucket with cement at the bottom to make sure it stands upright.
Yeah.
I will be taxidermed.
Yeah. Not like a little plaque or
into
something?
Into eternity. No, I don't want a plaque. I just want to stand
there. What do you want to be wearing?
Some sort of freaky ghost.
Some sort of Braves gear.
Braves World Series shirt.
Like what I'm wearing.
Live forever.
Whenever I go, it's what I had on.
Right.
Right? Just put it on.
I'm not picky.
Right? Yeah.
And
maybe a velvet smoking robe and my hair slicked back.
Yeah, maybe.
Lastly, as we...
I'll be there soon.
As we barrel towards Super Bowl 56 in 2 weeks from Sunday, the Bengals and the Rams get set to play, and we wonder if Tom Brady's going to hang up and sail away from his NFL career. Tom Brady, for the longest time, has been the forefront and face of the league. So it begs the question, if Tom Brady sails off into the sunset, who assumes that mantle as the face of the NFL? Is it the obvious choice of Mahomes, or could it be the guy who's certainly charmed America this weekend, Joey B?
I would take the staying power of the Chiefs organization over that of the Bengals. That's what was a surprise. There are so many good quarterbacks right now. That's TBA, but right now it's Patrick Mahomes. I mean, it's not even close. He's on all the commercials. He's sneaker guys. You know, everywhere you look, it's Patrick Mahomes. He's got the hardware. He's got the Super Bowl. He's got the MVP. I mean, for now, it's a pretty easy transition. It's Patrick Mahomes. That's not close. Now, that being said, there are some good young guns, and hopefully we have one here that can challenge that. But immediately, and it may be him already, by the way.
How about them Jags?
You know, at least on the field.
Yeah, yeah. A good answer. I'll take a shot at this. It's obviously it's Patrick Mahomes, but damn it, Saqib. If we don't have hope, what do we have? And if I can't get sunshine getting going here and slinging the ball all over the field and you calling on Sundays –
with tears of joy.
With tears of joy and not anger in your voice. And what are we doing, Saqib? What are we doing? If not now, when? We were gift-wrapped Trevor Lawrence, Saqib. Gift-wrapped him. They handed us to him. We worked for that. We went through loss after loss after loss, Saqib, to secure the rights to Trevor. We cannot blow this.
We got
hire somebody. Hire the right guy. And let's go!
Hell, we kept tanking!
Come on, Saqib! If not Trevor as the face of the NFL, then the hell with it!
You know, Dan, I appreciate what you just said. And also, you're a co-host. He said, oh, I feel sorry for you at the beginning of the phone call that Saqib is on being a judge. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm not going to give it to you just because you said that. I'm giving it to Dan, the man.
Yeah!
You're the man!
Woo! Let's go! Come on!
Now, Saqib, don't hit that fireball while you're driving, buddy.
No,
all right?
Be careful.
Safety first.
Saqib, thank you. If you may have some as well. Jeff, do you want? Jeff,
Hello.
Jeff. Jeff.
Hello.
Hello, Jeff.
Anyone?
Jeff.
Byron.
Here we go.
Let's do it.
Fireball.
Oh. Holy hell.
Woo!
Wow.
Woo!
Did you put more cinnamon in that?
A couple things. Tomorrow is second round of National Signing Day. So Florida, Florida State, Miami, with Mario Cristobal, what are they going to be able to do? I went and looked at a bunch of the top 10 guys who haven't committed yet, and I'm happy to see Florida's name on a bunch of those lists, man. Now, will they get any? Who knows? You know, if they do, boy, impressive.
If Gator fan is paying attention, it's already a grand slam by Billy Napier that he's even gotten in the mix.
Oh, for the recruiting.
That he's built from the raised eyebrows that you basically didn't honor any of those that you had handed out.
Yeah.
At one point, the class was down to three commits before the early signing.
Yeah.
Kept some inroads, got a couple of the highly thought of guys back. And then since has added, look, they're 26th in ESPN, and if they get a couple of these kids, they're going to have a top 20 recruiting class.
What I like about Billy Napier, too, as far as the recruiting is, if you look at the top guys from Louisiana, they added Florida to the list. So Billy Napier, two things. One, he can identify who the top players are from Louisiana, which I mean tells me he'll identify who the top players are from Florida here going forward. And two, he carries enough cachet and clout from his time out there where they weren't going to go to his school, but now that he's at Florida, yeah, coach, I love, you know, he's talked to these kids, so he's gotten them on the list. So, you know, again, I don't know that he'll get any of them. He might get the Perkins kid, which would be great, but most people still think he's going to go to Texas A&M, but I don't know. I mean, who knows?
And by the way, there's also this, which you thought you would have no hope of. What if he's behind the scenes? What if he gets three?
Yeah.
I mean, you're immediately talking about next year, a guy who looks like he's going to be a top three recruit. He's going to listen, when Kirby went to Georgia, they didn't have the street cred or recent results to become what they've become.
I think Billy Napier, I think we can say this with 100% certainty. Billy Napier far understands the recruiting game much better than previous staff.
For sure.
Right? I mean, so that part is we should feel good about going forward. All right. In other words, I don't think we're going to have to, next year at this time,
no, they're going
to
be in the top.
I don't think we're going to have to make excuses and say, well,
no.
Or they're going to sign like five guys after who they know will never get to campus to boost up their numbers.
Which Florida has kind of been guilty of doing the last few years.
Yeah. And I think that's the main reason why Florida football has struggled.
Texas
so
A&M
much.
Is in position to have their first ever number one recruiting
yes.
class, but they've got some shaky commits who are looking in other directions, and that includes that Harold Perkins kid that Florida Gators are in on. But there's a column right now on ESPN Plus, the 22 college football recruiting class rankings, and then it's especially highlighting some teams that are making moves. And about Florida, when Billy Napier took over the Gator program, he had a lot of ground to make up.
Mm-hmm.
Florida's class had fallen outside the top 50.
Mm-hmm.
However, they were able to build some momentum out of the early signing period and are now continuing to push their way up the rankings, improving the depth of the class with multiple three-star commitments, including safety Miguel Mitchell, who can be a punishing hitter. The Gators have now moved inside the top 35, also in position to continue to rise in the final days. They're in the running for several several of the remaining highly touted prospects like Perkins. And then you go down, and I want to say they were 35th. I thought they were, they're 35th. I saw them 26th somewhere. That may have been 247's consensus.
Where is FSU right now? Because they're
like 15.
Really? Because they've really hit the portal hard and done a great job.
And so has Florida. I saw a recent comment had Miami, Florida, Florida State all as portal winners.
Yeah.
But if you're relying on the, portals are for suckers. If you're just, unless you're taking, here's how the portal works. When it works like Bama works it. When you get a really good player, you don't have five guys starting on your defensive line who are portal guys. And it seemed like there were times last year in Gainesville that felt like the case.
Yeah.
Right? Couple from Auburn, one from, just a bunch of guys.
Right.
If the portal works, you go get a difference maker and then talk to me.
Right.
And, other than that, it is what it is. FSU's 20.
Mm-hmm. So it'll be, listen, strap in this state, gang, because, you know, I know there ain't nobody better than Bama. And Georgia's right there, too. They're the two top dogs. But my hope is the poaching ends now with Billy Napier, even Cristobal, and what Norvell's going to have to up his game as well. Those three guys, they should own this state. They should not let Alabama and others come in.
Well, it's clear by some of the – I guess my point back to Napier and why, if I'm a Gator fan, I'm already impressed, is to make the inroads that he has, considering just the terrible pall that was over the program by the end of the year.
I mean,
the fact that you're elbowing out, you're boxing out some commits who had, you know, said they were changing their mind and going to Georgia or Alabama, to get them back in to now be, you know, fighting for top, you know, 100 recruits.
Yeah.
Well, some of the few that are left. Again, if he can pull off the miracle and get, like, all three of these kids.
A couple things. One, it's not just the football standalone facility. I can show you the food, the pictures of the food.
Yeah.
We've upgraded the food.
Yeah, big time.
We're not just handing you some sandwich.
Yeah, they had, you know, that. Yeah, big plates.
Steaks,
pasta,
and shrimp. And and number two, you know, no more parking tickets, you know, for you guys. You know, you park here, you won't
like
get a parking
ticket. Should be. It's your playground. Go do what you want on campus. We don't give a damn. This is The Drill. We'll come back.
I'm a football player. Okay, good seeing you.
We'll come back with more next.
We're here to win.
Catlin Truck Accessories Tuesday.
Yeah?
Since you're answering the phone, I'm going to assume this is the man in charge in there?
Yeah. I'm in charge.
All right. I want to talk to Mr. I want to hear from him that everything's okay inside the house.
F*** you. I'm running this sh-. You talk to me.
That's right. You are running this. Tell me you're the man in charge. That'll be your responsibility. You understand?
F*** you. Don't try and play me. You get us a helicopter to fly us out of this.
Just a local paper pusher.
Get me a f***ing helicopter before I start shooting people.
Be cool. Be cool.
That's a negotiations with Trent Baalke down at the stadium this morning.
Oh, wow.
They have Baalke cornered in an office down there. But, yeah, he's threatening to come out shooting.
It has gotten tense down there.
Yeah, trying to clear the office of Baalke before Peter.
And we got to get Doug Peterson in there today.
Before Doug Peterson gets here, we're hoping that maybe we can, you know, Baalke has held the organization hostage now for 46 days. We've called in a negotiator.
Doug has agreed to wear a wire.
Some of my kids in class yesterday who are – and it's nice to have. I got this semester. I got a bunch of Jacksonville kids, so they're Jag fans. You know, they're the young, you know, and they're depressed. And we talk about the coaching situation, but they were telling me yesterday. And again, I'm just talk radio in this one, that the kismet's down in the Caribbean right now. And then I go, well, how do you know? Well, we follow it, and there's private planes going. But now I will say this. The old man TC interviewed on the Kismet down in Miami for the job.
And again, he leases it out too.
Yeah. Also, right. So, I mean, it may be down there. The Kismet's always bouncing around. I mean, the Kismet doesn't sit docked here all the time. The Kismet is in use. So, but it made me laugh. Like, they're trying to tell me Sean's on a Caribbean vacation. I said, come on, man. You're on a Caribbean vacation now.
Yeah.
But again,
They have circled back, though.
Totally improbable.
Circle back for a second interview with Doug Peterson. And again, the hostage negotiation is well underway down there. And it feels like Baalke's getting a little bit itchy down there. I mean, he threatened now to start shooting if he doesn't get the helicopter. I don't know if he's going to take Sean with him or Leftwich or the fan base. I don't know, but he's holding someone hostage.
All right, we talked about this at the top of the show, Copycat League and stuff. But here's another team that is definitely going to be in the market for a quarterback, and that's Washington. Right, the Washington football team, they only have one quarterback under contract, and that's Taylor Heineke, who, you know, is a serviceable guy, but he's not a franchise guy. Yeah. Yes, perfect. Yes, Minshewy. Just pop him in and
watch some numbers.
Have you a couple good ones. Yeah. And then,
always have numbers that make you go, I wonder.
Yeah, so they are definitely going to be in the market. They're going to go hard after guys like Rodgers and Wilson and Watson and try to build this team. They've got some good pieces. They've got a 1,000-yard receiver in Terry McLaurin. They've got a good running back, Gibson kid, right? He was a 1,000-yard rusher, wasn't he?
He was good. If he didn't get to 1,000, he was close.
Curtis Samuel's back and those kind of guys. You've got Chase Young coming back from an injury. So there's some talent there. They need – They need a guy. So this is going to be a really interesting offseason with the chess pieces working. And I think teams are going to be willing to give up more than they would have previously because of the success of the Rams. That's all I was saying. But that's another example of a team who definitely is going
to
be in the
market. Man, what has happened to the running back production, man? This has got to be a record.
We only had a few.
Once we went to 16 games, I mean, this is 17.
Yeah, 1,000 should be.
Only seven guys had 1,000 yards rushing.
Was Gibson one of them?
Yeah, he 1,037.
Yeah.
Ezekiel Elliott, who got all that money, 1,002 yards.
Yeah, he was terrible. What did he average?
4.2.
He did average 4.2. I'm surprised.
But you had Jonathan Taylor led the league 18-11.
Yeah.
Nick Chubb, 1,259. Joe Mixon, 1,205. Yeah. Najee Harris, 1,200. Dalvin Cook, 1,159.
You get 1,200 yards, that's a good year, man, for a running back.
Yeah, and there's only four of them that did. I wonder, I mean, I can probably go back by years here. I can't imagine there were few, maybe it's seven. One, two, three, four, five, seven, only seven running backs over 1,000 yards. And that's with extra game. That's 17 games. Wow. That's amazing. Let me just look 2020. Yeah, 2020 had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I mean, it's still more than 7. I wonder if 7 won't be.
Well, the 1,000-yard receiving season has replaced the 1,000-yard rushing season.
But look, just 2019, 16,000-yard rushers.
Yeah.
And that's in a 16-game schedule.
Yeah. Well, go back 20 years and look and see how many 1,000-yard rushers versus how many 1,000-yard receivers, because I know that 1,000-yard receivers are, I don't want to say a dime a dozen, but they've certainly – there's teams with 2,000-yard receivers.
The 2004 regular season, there were 18,000-yard rushers, including Fred Taylor, who was 10th in the league at 1,224.
You go, Freddie T.
And let's see, 1,000-yard – what did I just say?
18.
18. 1,000-yard receivers that year, 24.
So
I wonder what I wonder what it is. Let me just to kind of post on this.
I bet there was 20
like this
year. Easy.
All right, so we receivers this year.
Yeah.
26. And only 7,000 yard rushers. Now, another thing that's happened, I don't know if overall rushing attempts or totals are down, but they're much more rely on two or three backs now than they used to. Used to be if you had a back, he was your back. The other guy'd carry it four times. You know, your guys might get one below here or there, but a franchise back would carry the ball all the time.
Yeah.
And now they split it up between guys in a lot of places.
All right, some other NFL news and notes. What would the market bear for Jimmy Garoppolo? He's got 1 year left on his deal. Reasonable rate. His base is 24.2. Some, you know, per-game bonuses and a workout bonus. And the reality is that teams that strike out on the Watsons of the world are going to go chase Garoppolo, right? That's what's going to happen, right? If you don't get,
I guess.
Like if Aaron Rodgers stays in Green Bay and Russell Wilson goes one place and Deshaun Watson goes another, or Russell Wilson doesn't go and just Deshaun Watson goes, they're all going to turn to Jimmy G.
I'm shocked that there was not a bigger storyline around exactly what this year is for Deshaun Watson and how he could have handled it. Because here's what I mean. Is he an S? Are they going to have to suspend him for a year?
I don't know.
Because it seems like this year you should almost just take in your lumps
and
got a suspension or whatever. But you feel like he's I don't know.
It's
be weird.
Odd situation. It's almost like the NFL in Houston's like, well, he's not going to play for us. He don't want to. And so the NFL's like, all right, let's just keep him inactive.
He's not on that suspended list or any of that stuff. So here's what's going to happen. As soon as he goes to a team where he's viable, they're going to say, hey, hold on.
Games.
Right, I'm wondering.
I don't know.
But that certainly can make at least some sort of – although he's young enough, that shouldn't matter.
I saw a good comparison for Jimmy G, Alex Smith.
Yeah, I think like Alex Smith's probably a little better.
Yeah.
You know, a little different.
Yeah, Jimmy G won more playoff games.
100%. I just mean better like skill set. Doesn't mean he's you know, Joe, a lot of people better than Joe Flacco, and he was great in the postseason.
Nathaniel Hackett, I saw this thoughtful answer on getting fired. The question was, how was getting fired in Buffalo and Jacksonville affecting him? And Hackett said, Richard Mann was one of my greatest mentors as a wide receiver coach at Tampa, and I remember he used to tell me, you don't become a real coach until you get your heart ripped out. And I never understood what that meant. And I think going through this profession, all coaches have, and I think when you have to go through that, there's something about becoming a real coach going through that adversity, because we're asked to help guys through losses, and we're asked to help people through all these different things that you go through as a football player, the ups and downs. So I think as coaches, you go through that stuff, and I think it makes you stronger, makes you better, and it's a great perspective I hadn't heard. So anyway, I think that was cool. We talked about this yesterday, where the Patriots go to replace McDaniels. This is in Sports Illustrated. Alabama OC Bill O'Brien makes the most sense. Like we talked about, we think it's O'Brien and maybe Doug Marone.
Wasn't O'Brien the OC there before?
Yes.
Years ago?
Yeah. Sure.
I heard Marone maybe OC to New Orleans.
Maybe that's it. O'Brien's background in the offense of the program is there. Mac Jones' presence in New England adds to it.
I think Mac's into the Pro Bowl, by the way.
He is.
I think it's filtered down to him.
He got picked.
Good for him.
Yeah, congrats. So, yeah, I would think Bill O'Brien probably would end up there. So,
Josh McDaniels is going to be interesting to see if he can cash in on his learning experience. He said something interesting yesterday, an admission that he was,
that was good.
A little bit over his head. If you don't remember, McDaniels went out, and he was a superstar right off the bat. That may have contributed to some of this comment we're about to hear. But, you know, don't forget, they started 6-0.
Yeah.
You know, he went to Denver, they're 6-0, and you know, went downhill from there. Here's what McDaniel said in his introductory press conference yesterday with Las Vegas. When I went to Denver, I knew a little bit of football. I didn't really know people and how important that aspect of this process and maintaining the culture and building the team was. And I failed, and I didn't succeed at it. Looking at that experience has been one of the best things in my life in terms of my overall growth as a person, as a coach. What do I need to do different? How do I need to handle my role if I have another opportunity and do better at it? I feel like that's really an area that I've tried to grow in. I know how important it is for a head coach to be able to do that.
Yeah.
And you know what? I can get that because that kind of culture almost becomes implied with Bill Belichick. He doesn't do it warm and fuzzy. You can't probably take that cold and distant approach in every locker room. And some you may need to be warm and fuzzy. And he may have gone to Denver and carried that you know, Belichick kind of aura.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not going to jive with everyone if you don't have the success built up to, you know, to use that particular style. So, anyway, kind of fell on the sword. And then listening to Matt Eberflus yesterday, I was just reminded of the bombarding of, like, cliche that happens in every single coach sits down, talks about changing the culture
and
how they're going to play with energy. And we're going to be fast and fast-paced. And, you know, you better bring your track suit. You know, all that kind of, you know, narrative that you hear now just about any – I heard it with Dable and I heard it with – excuse me, with Eberflus.
Well, that's the thing. That's why I keep saying that when the Jaguars finally do introduce their new and their next head coach, you know, he'll come out and he'll say a lot of the same things, and that's fine. I mean, he should. You know, hey, these fans deserve a winner. We got Trevor Lawrence. We got a number one pick. I look forward to working with these guys. We're going to be active in free agency. I want football players. We're going to be aggressive on offense. We're going to attack on defense. All this stuff.
Right.
Yeah, right.
They all say the same thing.
And then he's going to be done, and every question I have is going to be for Shad Khan. There's a Shad Khan question over here.
Are you lazy? No. That's what Uche said.
I mean, look, he hasn't even addressed Urban Meyer yet.
No.
And I know, and Shad Khan probably will go, well, that's a question for, you know, another day, or, you know, today's about new coach blank here, you know. But, yeah, but we never got to talk to you about, you know, so we want to know what happened there, and –
here's the thing. There's nothing wrong with taking a long search if you give the impression that you're in control. You get the impression the Jags aren't in control of this search. That's what's disconcerting. I mean, it's all over the place. You know, you hear things, this guy's out, and then he gets a second here. It's like I would really love to know what's going on in these meetings. If coaches really are leave saying, to hell with that. I'm not working with that guy. I'm not working at that place. I don't like what I heard there.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it'd be real nice. And we'll never know. No one will be honest on just what they said, what they encountered, how it went. It's like I said with you earlier with Leftwich. I'd really be curious to know when Byron Leftwich decided he didn't want to work with Trent Baalke. Did he come into the meeting with that thought just on what he's heard around the league? Mm-hmm. Was he put off by, you know, his conversations, his interaction with Baalke in the meeting? It's just it'd been fun to have been a fly on the various walls where these interviews have taken place. I mean, Hick, what sense does it make at this – it's not even the 11th hour. It's the 20th hour to go interview Rich Bisaccia. I mean, this guy was an interim coach on a team that fired him and replaced him with a much more sought-after guy. And you're going to take those leftovers?
I would think that the way to go is to go back to the guys like Peterson and Caldwell
right.
and talk to and find out. You know, you've interviewed a pool of eight guys.
I think it's 10.
Well, but the original ones. If you can't get any of the original ones, any of the eight, if none of them are going to be a good coach, then you're not doing it right.
And you know what?
And if none of them are coming because of the GM, then you got a problem.
And you're right about Flores. Why isn't he up here interviewing?
Yeah.
I mean, where he's been successful.
Yeah. I would have talked to him.
I want some guys who have been a coach in the league and they've been successful.
Yeah.
I was good with Byron. And I think he's a smart guy. I think he would have been a good coach. I'm disappointed that he got all demandy. If he did. Fair enough.
All right, a couple other things. We've got the Lockett Law High School report coming up later today. No, before you blow, we'll talk to some area high school athletes. So that's coming up on the docket. And then I've been meaning to say this, and I haven't asked you. This is the one thing that stands out to me about the PGA Tour so far. And when does Brunch with the Tour begin?
I think next week.
Next week, February 8th. All we're right. back. All better right. than ever.
All right. So we get to get after get so after.
What were we gonna say?
There's one thing that stands out on the PGA Tour that I saw this weekend that shook me up a little.
When
bit.
We come back?
No, tell me right now. It's not that big a deal, but it shocked me.
The old Saturday finish.
No, well, that's true. I didn't know about that.
That was the most shocking.
That was.
And for some reason,
particular player.
Wednesday, Saturday.
One particular player in the new look he's got. What
Zalatoris?
The hell? No. What did he do?
Just got bigger. He looks.
Oh, he did?
Remember how skinny? Well, I mean,
he's so skinny.
Yeah, you look at him last year. Okay, I watched a lot of golf.
Yeah, you know. Once I say, but I mean, this guy. I mean, it's just
he changed his hat. Not DeChambeau with the hat change.
No.
It's not that big a deal.
No, maybe hair color. How about that?
Who was it? I don't know.
Koepka.
Oh, I missed him. I never saw him.
Did I not see him blonde? Or am I wrong?
I didn't. I never saw him all weekend, so I don't know.
Hold on, maybe I got it wrong.
Well, if it shook you to your core, it better be right. Yeah, he bleached blonde.
Yeah,
Koepka's an odd bird, man. Right, he's an odd dude.
Yeah.
What a flop that match with DeChambeau was too.
Yeah, Brooks Koepka went blonde.
Platinum, Billy Idol blonde, or
remember when Tiger did that?
No,
you don't.
That felt like a crisis.
Vaguely, yeah, that was almost like Britney shaving her head if Tiger did that.
Come look at the Brooks Koepka edition.
He look like Slim Shady.
I guess he's.
What's going on? Like, how blonde is it? Is it like platinum?
Yeah.
Or is it like sometimes when dudes like try to like bleach
Idol
their
blonde.
Brown hair and ends up looking like urine?
What are we doing here?
I don't know. He's having fun.
I guess.
He's living the dream, man. He's a young guy.
He's still with that.
Oh yeah.
What's her name? Emma or what's
you know.
What is it? Sims? What's that girl's name? Who's he with?
I can't believe you don't remember Tiger.
Tiger blonde. I vaguely do. Vaguely. His was never full blonde. It had to have the black shining through, wouldn't it, kind of?
Let's see if I can find a pic.
Just the frosted tips?
Yeah, here we go. Oh, he went blonde on us for a little while.
Frosted the tips?
Yeah.
Total blonde?
Come over here.